Welcome back to the Dynasty Digest, where we give you a consumable Dynasty perspective. My name's Jake, joined as always by Tim. We're going to run through our Dynasty takes through this point in the season. Tim's got a few topics that he really wants to talk about. We're going to dive into those. I'm going to give you guys a solid 10 seconds, though, to just scroll on down and hit that subscribe button.
Welcome. You're listening to JWB Fantasy Football. Thanks for listening.
Like I said, we're going to talk some Dynasty mid-season. Week 5 just occurred. We're moving on to Week 6. But Tim has some discussion points that he wants to talk about this week. But before we do that, if at any point in the video you guys like the video, make sure you scroll down and hit that like button. Leave some comments if you disagree with us, because we love conversation. But Tim, why don't you take it away? What are some of these topics you brought to the table this week?
Yeah, the first one I want to talk about is Bijan. We haven't seen elite production from him. We're not even seeing him run up the middle. Everything is zone outside. What are your thoughts on Bijan? Is he ever going to reach his peak? Are we way too high on him on our valuation in terms of where we have him ranked? When is the time to give up? Elite value versus minimum points? What are we thinking?
Yeah, so I actually think this really brings in a very good conversation about usage versus production. And a lot of the times at this point in the year, this early in a player's career, even a guy like Bijan who came in with super high capital, I just want to see some progression in the usage. I want to see things, you know, looking favorably towards him. And that's where I am still in on Bijan, and I'm not as panicked as I've seen a lot of people be. So in 2023, in his rookie year, he had a 68.6% snap share, 52.5% opportunity share. Those numbers have both jumped up this year so far. He's sitting at a 78.7% snap share, which is fourth on the team. His opportunity share is at 70.4th in football. 70.3% opportunity share, which is 12th in football. The main thing that I've seen out of Bijan this year, the targets obviously look a little bit different. He's still running routes at a high rate. It's just Kirk Cousins. Kirk Cousins, you know, the first couple weeks, he was still clearly getting comfortable on the leg. But this is a team that's also been productive in scoring big touchdowns. They've also seen drive stall out, where Tyler Allgeier has mostly been in there, and they have to just settle for field goals. But when it comes to, you know, what I'm seeing out of Bijan on the field, I'm not seeing things, you know, really go too negatively, even though his route participation this year is down. So last year he was at 72.6%, which was second in football. This year he's at 56.3%, which is still sixth amongst running backs in football. Like, there's still a lot to really like about Bijan. Touchdowns clearly haven't been there for him. He's got one touchdown through 5 games so far this year. But the receptions, you know, the receiving numbers still look pretty good. He's pacing for 54 receptions on the year, which is just 4 less than he had last year. He's pacing for more rush attempts than he had last year as well. Like, I'm not panicked on this usage. I'm still seeing a lot of really good signs. And I think it's just going to be one of those situations where the usage is good enough. The team just hasn't really had to lean on him like we kind of expected this Falcons team to maybe have to at times. But I do think we're going to see a lot of positive regression in terms of Bijan's production. So I'm not adjusting him at all in my ranks. I'm not, you know, dropping him. Also, state of the running back position, there's not a lot of guys to put ahead of him. And I also wasn't a Bijan running back one guy to begin with. I had Breece over him going into the year. I haven't seen enough out of Gibbs. Gibbs receiving usage is down. He was the only other guy that was really contesting, you know, that top spot for me. And with the CMC injury, you know, yet again missing, you know, probably a half year of football is what it's looking like here. I don't see anybody to realistically put over Bijan, and I'd rather just not panic on what we know is an elite talent.
That's kind of how I'm feeling. I've been seeing opportunities to trade him for X running back in a first. I'm like, that's a big step down. And I understand, like, the tier down, if you can get reasonable production with that additional first, that's nice. But we got to remember this about, like, elite running backs, or even like above average to like good running backs. Like, even if we're talking Tony Pollard, right? Everybody was off the Pollard train, but that just made Pollard someone that was, you're able to go get, because he was never dead. It was just, he was in a bad situation, but we know he was electric enough to score touchdowns, or in, you know, he was talented enough to handle a workload as well as be the guy to score touchdowns. And I think that's the same way with Bijan. I don't think that the offensive line was properly evaluated. Like, they're like, oh, this is one of the top tiers, such and such. I know they've had some injuries, but like, even whenever Bijan gets breakaway runs, they get penalties and it gets called back.
Yep.
Or breakaway screen passes, all that stuff. So I think that stuff gets cleaned up. You see better point totals. If he has that big catch and run and potentially touchdown against Tampa Bay, we're probably not even having this conversation. And it got called back. So I think it's more cool, like, kind of, let's cool our Jets a little bit. And speaking of the Jets, the same thing I feel about with Breece. They've had issues with the blocking. It has nothing to do with Breece being a bad running back. It's he's getting hit before the ball's even handed off to him. That stuff gets cleaned up. And let's say he gets targeted more in the passing game when they don't have to stay in the block almost every single time. You'll see more production.
Yeah. The Jets are the dead last team in football in yards before contact allowed. When it comes yards before contact per attempt this year, let's just say you got to scroll quite a bit also to find Bijan Robinson's name on that list. Neither of these teams' offensive lines have been good. And that's another thing where I don't like simply looking at pure production to evaluate a player. So that was a thing that a lot of people got on me on. I made a tweet. I saw people disparaging Caleb Williams' performance this past week against Carolina because it was Carolina. And it was specifically on a tweet where they brought up Caleb throwing for 200 yards in the first half. And everybody was saying, oh, it's Carolina. Anybody could do that. And I was like, all right, let me look. No one's done that besides Caleb this year. And then the people who tried to argue it argued it with, okay, but these other teams who didn't do it are run heavy teams, or they were up by a ton, except for the fact that only one of the run heavy teams had less pass attempts than the Bears did, and that was the Chargers. And the Bears were also up 27-7 at half. Like, the arguments, you need the entire context of the argument or of the situation when you're discussing anything to do with football and production. So if you look at Bijan specifically, so the usage, like we talked about, has increased this year. Things that have decreased, the breakaway run rate is down by about a full percent. What can we look at as the potential reason for that? Well, is run blocking rating. So on Player Profiler, they have a stat called run blocking rating, which is essentially combines a couple stats into a universal metric to break down the efficiency of the offensive line in their run blocking. Last year, his run block rating was 46.0, which translated to 13th in football. This year, that number is 25.4, and that's 35th in football. So that's probably a reason why the breakaway run rate is down. We're looking at the touchdowns. Touchdowns are down to 1.4%. And people are probably thinking, oh, it's the goal line touches. He has two goal line touches on the year because Atlanta's been able to score from farther out. He had two goal line touches in all of 2023. Like, the over every underlying metric for Bijan's usage is up. It's where we want it to be. It's the direction we want it to go. Even, you know, you could argue his target share, it's down. It's down about 6%. But also, Kirk Cousins is throwing the football. It's never going to be as good as Desmond Ridder, who the running back might be the only player position on the field that he could consistently see was open.
And so, like, can't even throw the tight end, to be honest with you. Can't even hit the right shoulder.
I don't even know if Desmond Ridder has a shoulder that works. Clearly, I've seen him throw a football. But like, everything about Bijan tells me the production is coming because the usage is there. And that's where I think people get too caught up in these arguments, because we can have these arguments. We have the same conversation about so many players. So like, one guy I was super heavy on coming into the year was Michael Pittman. I thought people were taking, you know, too big of a knock on him for Richardson. They were, you know, and maybe they were right to an extent. You know, his production with Richardson hasn't been that phenomenal this year. But again, the usage has been really good. 26.2% target share, 36.4% red zone target share, 28.7% target rate. Like, everything tells me this is a guy I want on my team. I just need things to fall in place. And it's a lot easier for me to be over market on that guy than try and project a guy like George Pickens, who I knew wasn't going to have a super high target rate. This offense wasn't going to be a pass heavy offense with the coordinator change. And there were so many people who were arguing for Pickens over Pittman, using essentially the same argument to build one up and knock the other down. And it just, it's things like that really frustrate me about dynasty conversations as a whole, because if the usage is good, 99% of the time, I'm going to be in on that guy. it could be a Carson Steele type guy who runs like the slowest 40 in recent memory in his position. But if you tell me that guy is going to get opportunity every single week, earning targets, earning touches in any way, constantly on the field, I'll prefer that guy over a guy like George Pickens, who needs to come off the field for 30% of the snaps for load management as a 24-year-old wide receiver with an attitude issue. Like, you need the whole context to evaluate these guys. And I think way too often we just get too hung up in just production or just one thing or the other.
Last question about these running backs. What are you paying for them?
I'm trying to pay a little bit less than I would have in season. But so when you say running backs, are we talking like Bijan and Breece?
Yes.
I'm paying top two running back prices for them because I still value them as the top two running backs in football. So I'm comfortable sending, you know, two future firsts and a second. And I don't think I'm overpaying at that price.
We've seen the market kind of drop in the last year, just in terms of all running backs. And I even heard a discussion today that it was like less than like 10 or 12 were worth the first anymore. So there's an interesting conversation just even discussing the future running backs coming into the league, but then you're guessing to see if they're even going to reach the marks or the high water marks of these two running backs.
But, and also, yes, I could say right now that I would prefer Ashton Jeanty to Bijan Robinson or Breece Hall, but that means I have to either be the worst team in football to get them or pray that the first that I have or am trading for is going to be one of the six. Let's be real, with Jeanty, he's going to be one of the top two players off the board. I think it's going to be him and Tet McMillan as the one and two. They're the very early one and two for me. Quarterback year. It's not a great quarterback year. A lot of running back talent. Some solid wide receivers as well. Again,
Carson Beck's going to steal some franchise's money. I'm going to tell you that right now.
You know who isn't? Cam Ward. I'm big in on Cam Ward, but that's a conversation that we should probably have over on our Devy show over here at JWB, which you guys should check out if you haven't yet. But yeah, I think we get too tied up into things we can't control. And so I just prefer to control what I can. And if I know I can buy a top two ranked running back for what I feel is a reasonable top two running back price, I'm going to do it.
Okay.
Thursday.
I want to jump to QBs now. I think I'm going to combine this. I had a couple notes on a couple different players. I want to talk Jaden Daniels, Geno Smith, and Josh Allen. First thing I want to talk about, Jaden Daniels, currently listed as the QB1 on Keep Trade Cut for Dynasty. Thoughts?
This is why we have an entire show that we do in the off season where we make fun of Keep Trade Cut and the rankings that end up on there. If you want to be super high on him, fine. I'll admit, you know, he's quarterback 2 in points per game right now. That's cool. It's early. It's still too early. Teams are going to adjust. He's probably not going to be that, you know, ranked that highly come end of season. It just feels too rich. Like, there's too many good established quarterbacks that I don't have the concerns that I have with Jaden. I can't rank him over Josh Allen. I can't rank him over Jalen Hurts. I can't rank him over Lamar. So there, he's at minimum 4 to me. And then I know CJ Stroud is a good quarterback. I know Patrick Mahomes is a good quarterback. May not be the best fantasy quarterback, but is a good quarterback. I know those guys are going to have jobs for 4 or 5 years minimum without even thinking about it. So like, we're looking at maybe quarterback 7, 8 range is where I start to consider him, you know, probably right in that range with guys like Kyler, guys like Richardson, if you're still high on him, some of the, you know, your Joe Burrows, your Caleb Williams, like that tier of players. I think anointing a guy quarterback 1 after 5 games is just generally irresponsible.
I'm a Jaden Daniels stan and I don't have him as QB1. So
yeah, it's,
I'm with you. Since we're talking QB1, let's move over to who we both probably have as QB1, Josh Allen. Now, Josh Allen is QB8 on the year, 18.6 points per game. He's actually matching Geno Smith, where actually Geno Smith has like 0.2 more than him. Geno Smith is QB7. He's QB8. Thoughts on Josh Allen going forward? Do we believe? I think that his lower score or lower averages are due to their lack of red zone opportunities currently based on where they've been scoring, you know, having to then they're not scoring on every drive, things like that, where the opportunities are down. Does that impact any of your future? What do you want to say? Future approach to it? Because, like, for example, we were talking Mahomes, right? I've always said that rebuilding teams that only have just Mahomes are doing themselves a disservice holding on to him when he was QB1 for the fact that it takes so long to build out a roster. You're wasting prime years where you could get valuable assets, or if his value drops, which I would assume, yes, it's most likely still somewhat up, but his value has definitely decreased from when he was QB1. So with that being said, is this an opportunity to buy Josh Allen, or are we seeing the plateau and hoping that these weapons become true weapons, or is he just going to become a back-end QB1 going forward in terms of points per game?
I think much like we were talking about with Bijan, like, I think it's just panicking. Wait, like, people redraft season hits, people get way too tied up in production. That's what I think is happening here with Josh Allen. Like, we're talking about a guy, 17 game season, he's pacing for, quick math in my head, 31 touchdowns, zero interceptions. Pretty good. He's got two games where his team hasn't allowed 10 points. You know, week one loss versus Houston, or this most recent week versus Houston, was maybe the worst game of his career. 30% completion percentage. I understand the weapons aren't good. I understand the offense changed. I think if this team continues to be a productive NFL team, they're going to make a move for a weapon in the offseason. We may even see it this year. There's already talks about guys like Davante Adams being traded. There's talks about guys like Amari Cooper potentially being on the move. If Amari Cooper ends up...
Give me Cooper in Buffalo.
Dude, you're telling me. Like, if a move like that happens, his value is going to spike up. So if there's a buy window right now on Josh Allen, I am all over it. I'm truly seeing nothing out of Josh Allen that's making me concerned. Anything concerning is team composition. And as we've probably said a million times in, you know, the probably 50 recordings that we've done, I'll buy the talent over the situation, because situation changes and talent really doesn't. I'm not worried about Josh Allen in the slightest.
I agree. And I think that this year we're seeing how top heavy the fantasy football world is. We have four running backs over 20. We have one wide receiver over 20 in terms of points per game average. It's, and it kind of, everything kind of falls to like 11 points per game to like wide receiver 36 and like running back 24. So it your top end production is thinner than it's ever been. And that's one of the reasons why now I think Brian Thomas Jr. has really solidified himself as someone that you want to get in Dynasty if you can. But like, that being said, if there's a buy window for Josh Allen, you have to go take advantage of it, especially if it's a team that is underperforming in the win-loss column and they're looking to retool or rebuild. Mm-hmm. I would go get them. I would take a bunch of assets, combine them, open up some roster spots at the back of my lineup or back to my roster, and go load up with some free agents and just start over again. And know I'm top-heavy, is just as top-heavy as fantasy scoring is this year.
Yeah, and I do want to bring up you know, something you kind of mentioned there too, where it's like, if you hold on to an asset too long, you know, you run the risk of leaving your roster top heavy, maybe not being a bad enough team to get high enough draft picks to be able to bring in top talent to rebuild with. When it comes to guys like your Josh Allens, like your Patrick Mahomes, like your Justin Jeffersons, like your guys at the top end of the rankings, I have zero issue moving those guys to begin a rebuild or as part of a rebuild. I just want to state that in those situations, your goal shouldn't be to get three firsts back for Josh Allen. Your goal should be to get another top 10 ranked quarterback, be that a Kyler, a Caleb Williams, some, you know, a Jaden Daniels, something like that, and picks on top of it. So you're still keeping productive pieces on your roster for the future, because you don't have to wait for those firsts to become, you know, the player that in theory you're going to draft with the pick. You can move that for a player down the line. So I think people get too tied into the idea of like untouchable players. It's something I've seen in a couple of my dynasty leagues this year as well, where people, you know, have decided this is the point they're ready to pull the plug. start the rebuild, but the guys that are going to bring the value back to their team are untouchable. So it's like, yeah, sure, you can have all the third, second, fourth round picks you want. You're not best players in Dynasty probably hit on 30% of seconds, 15% of thirds, and whatever 1/12 of the fourth, like whatever 1/12 is as a percentage. Your odds
like 8.5.
Yeah, something like that. It's not good. It's bad. So like, what is the point of declaring a guy with elite value to be untouchable if your goal is to be to rebuild? Those are the guys who are going to get you the pieces to rebuild. You have to let go. This is the sunk cost fallacy all over again. And we need to get out of that mindset in general as a Dynasty community, because it's how you get stuck on the treadmill of mediocrity. Shout out Dynasty Zoltan for that name there. It's a great name for it though, because on a treadmill, you really don't go anywhere. And if you're stuck with four great players and a bunch of garbage forever because you can't hit on those picks or can't move anybody or won't move anybody of value, it's just a great way to hate your life playing Dynasty.
Yeah, and the return is fragile. You have to make sure that the return you're getting is correct.
Yep.
But at the point where you have no other assets to improve your roster, like I said, you're just wasting years. Where in reality, you need to be as mobile as possible when it comes to mobilizing, where everything you have is a weapon or a tool to go get you, I don't want to even say win trades, but to go get you better assets or put you in positions to access different players. And I agree with you about moving down and getting picks and still having a quarterback, because you can never have too many quarterbacks. And I say that because the last quarterback I wanted to discuss was Geno Smith being QB7, right? He was left for dead time and time again. Part of the reason why I wanted to bring him up, I was going to ask, is do we see this continuing, especially because of how poorly Seattle has handled pressure? It really can sink their passing game. But Geno has been scoring points all season, and it hasn't been where he's had like one good game. It's been pretty consistent throughout the entire season. So just in that example, by having those tools, those opportunities on your roster, you just don't know when they're going to turn and hit. And you got yourself another top 12 scoring option that you put in your lineup, and you've then solved both of those positional issues, and you can focus on something else with those picks that you've gotten from your other trades.
Yeah. I mean, Geno's obviously the most extreme example of that, 'cause he was like quarterback 5, the first year he started in Seattle, quarterback 7 so far this year. But you can even go down the quarterback rankings and see guys who were left for dead, who have just proved at the quarterback position, who have just been proven producers at this point. Like Derek Carr, say what you want about him, the man, the last like 10 games that he's played as a fantasy quarterback are like quarterback 10 numbers. Baker's like quarterback 8 over the last 10-12 games that he's played. Like these guys were left for dead, and I was buying Baker for fourth round picks, and now I have starting quarterbacks. Or in startups this year, I was getting Sam Darnold in the 21st round, and until this past week, he was a top 10 fantasy quarterback. Like when it comes to value, like obviously in Superflex, quarterbacks typically maintain the most value, but it's also a sign that when their value drops, it's some of the best times to take that shot, because a third round pick is nothing. A fourth round pick is nothing. You want those as a throw in on a trade with me? If it gets me the trade I want done and you get a third round pick and you feel happy about it, awesome, take it. I don't care. And if that's what it's going to take for me to get these guys on my roster, I mean, hell, I was sending third round picks for Gardner Minshew, and that got me through a couple weeks. Whereas like I needed a quarterback, especially on teams where I went fragile at quarterback. And, you know, I was going into the season with a Josh Allen, Jalen Hurts type and a Justin Fields as my quarterback. Obviously it ended up working out. The Fields, you know, got named the starter. But I've also got teams where I went Anthony Richardson and then his production was down or he was hurt, and I was able to plug in a guy like a Minshew or a guy like a Darnold or a guy like a Baker. It's you're never going to be mad when the sixth quarterback on your bench becomes a starting quarterback in the NFL and you can flip him for a different player or picks. Like I've got a 10 man super flex team where I've got 8 starting quarterbacks currently. I don't need them, but the trade returns haven't been worth it yet. And this goes back to the conversation we had with Alan. Once the return hits the right number, cool. Otherwise, I'm going to keep hoarding those points on my bench. I have a good team in that league. And when you guys want to come pay up for a quarterback, you can, because it hurts me zero in a deep bench league to have those guys on my bench.
I agree. I wanted to add something to it. We're seeing, especially with even like older quarterbacks like Flacco, right? We're seeing that let me back up. To me, the NFL in terms of defensively is changing. I don't think you can even evaluate players that played 5 or 6 years ago the same way you can now because of how athletic, strong defenses are, as well as the schemes that they're being played in. That you can see guys even like Flacco, how their ability to read a defense is so important and how it gives them longevity. I think that going forward, we're going to have a lot more instability of incoming rookie quarterbacks coming into the league, where we can't just say, oh, hey, they did this in college, they're going to be able to do this in the NFL, because of how much more difficult it's going to be to read defenses to execute the way that however you were playing in college. Like, it's not just going to be a copy paste. That guys like Minshew, right? He's in the best, most positive term I can say this in. He's the cockroach of the NFL. He's going to be around forever. He is going to be a guy that's going to continuously get spot starts.
He's our generation's Ryan Fitzpatrick.
Yes, because he's proven that to a certain level he can perform, and there's always going to be a need for that in the NFL.
Yeah, it's. I mean, you talk about with like the changing of schemes and defensive skill sets. I mean, you see it with a guy like Brock Purdy. Brock Purdy came into the league, shocked everybody, dissected defenses so well. And then you see that game against Minnesota, where Minnesota just dummied him, in my opinion. And he's going up to Brian Flores, hugging him after the game, being like, your scheme is crazy. Like, when you have defensive coaches like him who can disguise coverages so well, who can show you cover zero, but it's cover six, or show you man, but it's a three drop zone with three guys in man and the rest of them are covering hard flat. Like, the defensive coaches are getting so creative because it goes back to like what you said with the athleticism. Like, we're hitting a point where we have defensive tackles running 4.5, 4.6 40s, DNs running 4.4s. Like,
and they can drop.
Yeah. Their change of direction is
don't
crazy.
Be surprised if a defense decides to invert at any time.
Yeah. It's
so, no, I'm with you.
Yeah, we're seeing a changing of the guard in the NFL. It's like we're seeing more small running backs be productive because that wiggliness in space, that change of direction, that burst is becoming more valuable than those guys who just lower their shoulder and knock a guy over and get you 6 yards. Teams want the home runs when they can take them, especially on the ground, because you can't get that through the air as much anymore. And when you can find guys who can beat you through, like who can do stuff to make you win through the air, I mean, a guy that you and I have been on very heavily in our redraft shows this year, Darnell Mooney. Darnell Mooney is a guy whose route running and speed combination is that in which you put him on a good offense with a good quarterback, he's going to be an impressive wide receiver. Like, we were in on him so early in the season, and we've just continued to ride that train, and it's worked very, very well for us there. NFL teams are finding the same thing. So like, you could be the most prototypical X receiver in the world. That role is not super important in the current NFL. Like, there's not many Calvin Johnsons out there anymore. There's a lot more Larry Fitzgeralds. There's a lot more, you know, DeSean Jackson type players, like, because the modern NFL needs that more than it has in years past.
And due to that, I think there's going to be a premium on wide receivers coming into the draft next year. And future seasons as well, because look at teams that don't have playmaking wide receivers. They suck. Or they're being carried by Josh Allen. Like, we thought.
Or Travis Kelce.
Or at least I thought that Curtis Samuel would have a glimpse of fantasy success this year. He's had none. And they're not even using him. And he's what we would consider a playmaker, like in a lot of situations, or like how you might line him up. But they're not even using him because he's not effective anymore. And so I think there's going to be a very heavy premium on wide receivers, which there always has been. I understand this going forward. For years, I was, don't draft wide receiver in the first round. You can find one later. They're not, you know, like, unless you're getting a Calvin Johnson or a Julio Jones, you don't draft him in the first round. That those days are gone. Like, there are going to be why, and I'm talking about NFL draft when I say that, not rookie drafts, but there are teams that are going to basically flip their entire wide receiver rooms in the draft next year.
They're at least going to attempt to. I mean,
yeah,
we saw it, you know, guys, that a guy that I don't think either of us expected to go into the first round of the draft, Ricky Pearsall, sneaks into the first round of a draft because, like you said, it's such an important position. Like, you have to have guys who are good wide receivers. You can't be the Chiefs. I think that's where the Bills were attempting to do this year, was try and be the Chiefs, just get by with a good tight end and get six receivers who can kind of play receiver in here. The issue is Dalton Kincaid is not as good as Travis Kelce, even at Kelce's worst with 1 foot. It's just, you have to have playmakers at every level. And I think that also leans into a dynasty argument too, that like, those playmakers, guys who can just be productive regardless of situation or regardless of things like usage, those guys are, like you said, are going to be at a premium. And that's where my target is going to be more heavily in rookie drafts moving forward, especially in 2025. There's a ton of playmakers. Those are the guys I want. I could take the safe value and go with Shedeur Sanders, Quinn Ewers, Carson Beck, Cam Ward in rookie drafts. But I think the running backs are going to be so much more productive. I think the top end wide receivers, especially your guys like Isaiah Bond, your guys like Tet McMillan, like those guys are going to go to good teams or teams that are just a receiver away. And I'm going to be all over it because that's what is going to separate fantasy teams and real teams in the next few years until we see yet another changing of the guard, because the league changes every like 5 to 10 years.
Yeah, unless you really have conviction about quarterbacks going forward in the rookie drafts, I don't think I'm going to be taking a ton of quarterbacks high. I want to shout out my buddy DeShane's, Fade DeShane's. He's been talking about this for a few years now, that taking rookie quarterbacks doesn't improve a rebuilder because it takes either so long for them to develop or they never do. And as we've seen, acquiring cheap QBs and hoarding top-end talent at wide receiver and running back can really flip your roster around pretty quick. I want to move into wide receivers. You good with that?
Yeah.
Okay. So there's a couple scenarios I kind of want to talk about. I have a couple guys I want to talk about as who I think are good buys, but I just want to talk scenarios first. We have KTC, once again, keep trade cut, has Garrett Wilson valued at wide receiver 13. Your thoughts on that?
I think it's pretty fair, honestly. Like, it's the production still, it's gotten better, but the production still hasn't 100% been there. We know the talent. Like, he's a guy. So again, going back to one of my tweets that got people angry or happy, regardless of how they took it or depending on how they took it. I tweeted basically that, like, there's a point where we have to just admit that players aren't good. And a lot of people thought it was a Garrett Wilson tweet. And he was the antithesis of what I was talking about there, because everything he shows us on an NFL field says this should be a very good wide receiver. The situation just hasn't been there. But I think as a dynasty community, we get too heavily focused on that at times too. Like the upside chase, this guy could be awesome chase. And there hits a point where we just have to accept what the league is showing us, because a guy like Garrett Wilson, yes, he still has that name value. Yes, he's still like super sexy to see that in one of your wide receiver spots in your roster. But when it comes time to win me weeks, is he going to do that much more effectively than who's wide receiver 14 and 15 on keep trade cut right now? Do you know?
I can look.
Like,
one second.
There comes a point where it's like the sexiness of the name no longer means something to me. Like Skylar and I, we have a team that we took over in one of the JWB subscriber leagues. And we've had Jordan Addison on our roster since we took the team over. Neither of us have been super high on Addison. He came back healthy, had a solid first game. We're like, all right, where's our out? Like, where can we get off Addison? Because the production has been good. His reception perception was not good. There's the questions on Sam Darnold, obviously. that people had coming into the year. So some people were down on him for that. I was one of them. I thought Justin Jefferson was going to be fine, and I did not think Jordan Addison was. But like we were talking back and forth and like workshopping an offer, and I just sent out a random Godwin in a second, and it ended up being a little bit of a bigger deal than that. But like Chris Godwin is still a guy. He's a guy that's productive, that's still relatively young, that I think is generally undervalued, and I get a pick on top of it. The production between Chris Godwin and Garrett Wilson, unless things change dramatically for one of them one way or another, I don't think it's going to be that different over the next 2 years. And I don't really like to think of Dynasty in more than 2-3 year windows at most. I think that's another mistake people make, is like thinking that, like I saw somebody talking about Patrick Mahomes, they're being like, oh, I'm going to have a quarterback for 10 years. It's like, you know how many Dynasty leagues actually make it 10 years? It's got to be like you and your best friends. That's the only way that league is making it 10 years in this day and age. So like there comes a point where the sexiness of Garrett Wilson starts to get outweighed by his production, regardless of what he shows us on the field. And unless things like rest of season keep going, you know, that 22 targets this past week, some crazy number like that. Like if stuff like that keeps happening, sure, wide receiver 13 may seem super cheap. But I think based off of the production that we've gotten out of him to this point, I think it's a really fair ranking.
I want to comment and push back a little bit on it, because I agree if he continues in this way, it's more than likely he's overpriced at like a cute or wide receiver 6 number. But I think, here's my comment. I think that the Jets are telegraphing based on the fact they can't pass block. So I think that there is a reason for why what's happening, but I also believe that it needs to get better. Otherwise, what is truly being, it's a prescriptive versus a descriptive position. If what is being described continues to happen, then the ranking may be more than accurate, because he's not going to get 22 targets every game. And because of the blitzing and because of the lack of protection, especially up the middle, I think the interior linemen on the Jets have played horribly, and the tight ends on the outside don't block well at all. Like outside of like the backup tight ends, I'm not talking about like Conklin, but if they don't improve, then anytime the ball goes to Garrett Wilson, he's never going to have space to operate. So he then has to just be a beast, which I personally believe he's a really good receiver and a really good athlete, where if he's in an offense that operates and functions properly, he has space and he does create yards after catch, things like that. But if that's not the case, you have to ask yourself, are you okay with holding on to, I don't want to even say sunk costs, but like if you pay X amount and then he's worth X amount later on, are you willing to bridge that gap and say, hey, I'm just living with whatever I get? That's the question you have to ask yourself. To answer your question, wide receiver 14 and 15 are DK and Devontae Smith. So just information there. So I think that that's something to look at, is when we're examining our risk appetites.
Yeah.
What are we going from there? And I think if you remove the name from players, it makes it easier to decide if you want to have kind of a process or repeatability of your steps or your thought process when evaluating players, just things like that. I'm one that's, I never go all in, because I like draft picks. I like flexibility, and I don't think I ever need to have the best team right now. I'm totally fine being the 6th seed if 6 teams make the playoffs. I don't care. Would I like to buy? Yeah. But am I in the dance? Yeah. And do I have the most flexibility and ammo to make changes at that point in time? You bet your ass I do.
Yeah. I think what you said about like taking the name away is super important. That was one of my biggest arguments when I talked all offseason about Dalton Kincaid. If I put a blind poll, rounded stats off so nobody could exactly look up who I was talking about, I gave 2 tight ends. The poll was 70% player A, 30% player B. And then if I put up a poll that was, who do you prefer in Dynasty, Cole Kmet or Dalton Kincaid, it was 90-10, but the 70-30 was 70% of people preferred Cole Kmet without the name attached to it. It's
I gotta say, I hate those blind resumes so much. I think they miss context. And I'll say this. I know where you're coming from and exactly what you mean in terms of if we are able to do this without the names, we're able to extract better value or anticipate setting our lineups better, all that stuff. But like, I feel like there's people that believe that there's more ceiling for Kincaid where like the raw current numbers don't matter. But I hear what you're saying. I'm not dispelling it, or I'm not trying to reduce or discount its value. I'm just, I in my experience over in Twitter in the past like 6-7 years, blind resumes always have an agenda.
Yeah, mine 100% did. It was just to prove the point that Cole Kmet had a better age 24 season in the NFL than Dalton Kincaid,
and that might be 100% true.
But what you said there is kind of my issue with what the basis of my, you know, tweet was about, that people thought was about Garrett Wilson. It's like, yes, Kincaid probably is, as far as I'll go, has more upside than Cole Kmet. But there comes a point where I have to see the upside. And even this year, Cole Kmet's outscoring Dalton Kincaid as the fourth receiving option on his team.
Yeah, he looks way more comfortable running his routes. Yeah. I always thought he was a good tight end. I just didn't like him for fantasy because he wasn't consistent. But he's literally winning from the slot and on routes that go to the sideline.
Yeah,
like that's a very difficult task for a tight end to do.
Yeah, and I think that way too many people just get tied up in chasing upside, and that's where a lot of teams get stuck. Like, I was never the highest on Anthony Richardson. I kind of begrudgingly ranked him as a top 10 quarterback because of the rushing upside. But he's proving again he can't really stay healthy. He still doesn't look that good as a passer. And there's more than 7 guys that I would prefer to have above Richardson. And it's like, you have to account for upside. Obviously, you don't want to just take bums who are on the field 80% of the time as a decoy or doing nothing. Like, obviously I prefer unhealthy Anthony Richardson over healthy Gardner Minshew. Like, that's a no brainer, but there comes a point.
The cockroach.
Hey man, I love him. Man tried to chug a like handle of Jack Daniels and break his hand. Like, there comes a point, like, we have to see that production. And there were signs that we weren't going to get that production out of Kincaid that I think too many people ignored because they were so high. Their sunk costs on Dalton Kincaid of him being first round tight end, potential wide receiver one in the Bills offense, 260 vacated, like, their perception of the situation wasn't accurate. And that's why I like to just look at things as unbiased as I can. And like, I joke all the time about how I hate Dalton Kincaid. I hate the fact that people hype up Dalton Kincaid when everything else tells me he's not as good as people think he is or could be. And that's why I like the blind resumes to an extent, because they just give me an objective view of the player. I go, this is what this player has proven to me so far they can do. And based off of that and other players who have done similar things, this is what I can project off of them or project them to do or project the upside to be. I think too many people go, Travis Kelce, his ceiling was like a, you know, wide receiver 3 as a tight end. Kincaid was a first round tight end. I think he could be the next Kelce. When, if you've watched the two play football, they don't play the position anything alike. And I think
nobody plays it like Kelce, and that's what people need to stop romanticizing.
Yeah. Like, for Travis Kelce, playing tight end that way works. For 99.9% of tight ends, playing like Travis Kelce does is not going to work. You also have to recognize Travis Kelce might be one of the greatest receiving tight ends we've ever seen.
Travis Kelce also played quarterback, so he knows how to read coverages better than most tight ends, which helps him be in the same mindset as Patrick Mahomes, which helps them complete passes because he creates alleyways for the balls to get to him, or he just sits in zone and he's open by 15 yards. And like, literally, they did that last week. Mahomes couldn't get him the ball because he couldn't get anything behind him because he was running.
Yeah. But, I mean, it just goes into the overarching dynasty argument of upside and chasing upside and ranking guys where we do because of upside. And so I really don't. Like, I like to just... I definitely include it. I definitely recognize it. For some positions, it matters for me more. Like, quarterback is one where the rushing upside has just shown me too much in terms of extra production that I have to, I can't not include it there. But when it comes to your wide receiver, your running back, your tight end, some of those things only matter to a certain point. Like, I'm never going to call Jahmyr Gibbs or Bijan or Brees the next Christian McCaffrey, because Christian McCaffrey is one of a kind in terms of his production, what he's capable of. And too many people go, this guy could be the next McCaffrey. All off season, who is this year's Puka? There probably isn't one. We're probably not going to see a guy like Puka come out of nowhere and just absolutely smash like that, at least for a few more years. They're going to be so rare to have guys like that, but people chase that upside, chase the high of those players when they just need to recognize that, like, hey, these other guys that we know were good, why don't we just focus on them a little bit and just go for those guys instead?
In my opinion, no one has played football in the NFL like Puka has ever. I'm not saying he's the greatest wide receiver ever. That's not what I mean. I don't think we've seen a mix of his skill set and his violence at the wide receiver position that we've ever seen. Like, we could talk about Hines Ward, but Hines Ward did not have the same skill set that Puka has. And Steelers fans, I don't want to hear it, because you over-evaluate and you love all your players way too much. Don't come at me. I'm with you, though. I think what you're saying is right. I have a couple truths. One is, cream always rises to the top, and the season is long but short. So we might be 5 weeks into the season. We're like, oh my God, we're already 5 weeks through. But the players that won't have sustained roles or won't sustain top-tier production, they fall off every year. And your true stud players always produce. Like, they may already be producing, but the point is that you will see that production occur throughout the season and through the end of the season. So
water always finds its level.
It's nice to have those players right now that are on every show, on every waiver show, or the start of the week. But that doesn't mean that they're going to be worthwhile in 2 weeks. And that's something where I feel people get in trouble, where they want to buy up real estate really fast on these guys.
Yeah.
And either you've spent all your fab or you've moved all your picks. And if you've moved them to me, I just get to sit there and watch your team fall down the standings, because you might have been in fifth place when you made this trade, and you're going to be in 11th place when the season is over. I did the transactional tidbits, and we had a conversation. Someone posted a comment about they traded Mason and a receiver for they traded Mason and Jameson Williams for Breece Hall. And the argument can totally be made, because if you are risk adverse, the argument can be made. Breece hasn't really been producing points, and Mason has, that I might be able to get a cheap running back that's kind of doing the same thing that Breece is doing and get upside with Jameson. I can understand that idea, but also Breece isn't always going to have like the worst offensive line and all this other stuff. And they're going to be in games in which he actually needs to score red zone points. And he's going to have games where he puts up 26, and you're gonna be like, I traded 9 points per game and potentially a 15 to 20 point per game for this guy that just literally just won this guy this week, or won this guy this league, or man or woman, excuse me, this league. So that's how there's just certain things. And also, I just want to tune in real quick with the rushing quarterback thing. Rushing quarterbacks should be thought of as how PPR wide receivers are. It makes them more predictable about the points they're going to score. It gives them the floor as well as the ceiling. So you're not hoping for 300 passing yard day and 3 touchdowns. You might get 200, 2, and 50 on the ground, and you're basically in the same spot. And then if they had a rushing touchdown with that 50, you're in front. So I think it gives you a smaller area for them to fall in terms of the floor. Maybe they have a QB12 floor, which is great, and you just know how to set the rest of your lineup. Can we move on to one more topic and then talk about our potentially buys and sells if we have any?
Yeah, definitely. I do want to make one last comment, though.
Yep.
About the rushing quarterbacks. If you look at the top I'll be generous and go to 10 just to get some outliers in there too. If you look at the top running backs or top quarterbacks this year, Lamar, Jaden Daniels, Baker, Burrow, Geno, Josh Allen, Kyler, Dak, Fields, and Darnold. Lamar, most rushing yards amongst quarterbacks. Jaden Daniels, second most. Kyler, fourth most. Fields, fifth most. Allen, sixth most. Geno, seventh most. Baker's even, you know, over 100 yards and two rushing touchdowns. This is why rushing does matter at the quarterback position, is almost every single quarterback in the top 10 has rushing upside. Burrow had it before, you know, pre-injury. Dak had it pre-injury. Darnold's shown it at times in his career. There's not one guy in the top 10 who has not shown us rushing upside in the past or is actively a good rusher. Like, it very clearly matters. Rushing. So I need people to stop saying it doesn't.
Rushing Dak did not miss because he was so cheap. It was so good.
It was so
fun. And then he got overpriced and hit 18 points per game most weeks when you had 11 QBs going over 20, which we don't have anymore. It was a very interesting time in the Dak value train. So I want to talk DVA, Davante Adams, potential trade. I don't want to talk landing spots because I don't care until it happens. But are you interested in any receivers outside of Bowers there? Are you interested in Tucker or Jacoby Myers? I know that there are some other below those two, but I don't, you know, there hasn't been enough production to even really isolate them as to guys to talk about.
Yeah, I am interested in buying Jacoby Myers before the trade happens. He's shown the ability to be a good targeter in the past, has been productive, even with Devontae there, was productive last year at times. Cost is probably, you know, non-prohibitive there, where it's a move that makes sense to me. No interest really in Trey Tucker. It's fun where I have him. I can plug him in a lineup here and there. But even if Devontae gets traded, I think the offense runs mostly through Bowers, especially with the lack of a rushing threat in the offense, because every running back they have there either sucks or doesn't get played.
Laub, play him. Play him now.
Worth a shot because Amir Abdullah, not great.
He had 11 points last week, bruh. Just kidding.
Good for him. Yeah. Anybody listening, if I have Amir Abdullah on a roster anywhere, just offer me a second or a third. I'll take it. I'll just do it.
I don't have any Amir Abdullah to sell. That's my problem.
Same.
No thirds for me.
Yeah, I have some slight interest, like I said, in Jacoby Myers, but not going out of my way to do it. But I would buy before the trade with Devontae happens, which, if you believe Kay Adams tweets at all, a lot of movement going on there. So could see that trade happening sooner rather than later.
To be honest, I'm interested in both of them. I had conversations about Tucker before Davante Adams news came out, because for redraft, I think he's got a tough 4 to 5 weeks before the bye. I forget. I could be confusing when his bye is, but I know he has about 4 or 5 weeks and it ends with Cincinnati, where Cincinnati is now proving to be kind of a passive, so they might not fall into this range anymore. But where you could kind of wait, where he had 2 good weeks in a row, kind of wait for that hype to fall down and buy him. But if there's a Davante Adams trade earlier, I think Trey Tucker fits what the NFL wants to do moving forward.
I would agree.
The question is, what we had the same conversation about Downs preseason. We all love Downs here, but it was predicting what the passing was going to look like. And he got 27%. 21% of the looks, his first week with Richardson. So it kind of like turned my faith around to where he was more of a every week starter. But with Tucker, if he can get consistent number of targets, I think he's going to be someone that is startable. Maybe how the way years ago, how we were perceiving Rashid Shaheed and now how we're perceiving him, he's still not really that valuable, but he is someone that gets played. I see how that could be. And I think that Myers is a guy that playoff team should be trying to hoard right now, especially if Davante Adams gets traded. I have one buy. I don't know if there's anything you want to respond back to what I said or not.
I don't think Trey Tucker is that good. That's really all it boils down to. But like you said, he fits what the NFL is looking for. He's a fast guy who can separate deep, and it's how you can beat, you know, a lot of the shell defenses we're seeing right now. So I don't hate it. And again, cost, I don't think is prohibitive there. He's probably super cheap. So
I my take this season, going into the season, was you need perimeter wide receivers that can push the safeties back. I have a buy. I'm hoping that you have one too. I didn't prep you for this, but I think that you should be buying Jake Ferguson. I think he's very underrated in terms of price right now. He's the tight end 5 on the season and half point PPR, including a game he got injured at Cleveland, which would actually push him up higher. Both if you remove or if you extrapolate out that game. I think that there's not enough consistent tight end play, that he's a guy that will basically, I don't say buoy you, but the consistent weeks he gives you, he will give you over the season an advantage at the tight end position, unless you're streaming and hitting every single week, which based on even just what I've done this year with sleepers, isn't easy to do.
Yeah, it's tight end sucks this year. I hate it. I hate it so much. Yeah, I mean, you didn't prep me for a buy here, but I think I'm just going to rock with the guy that we were talking about a little bit earlier in Darnell Mooney. Like, I don't think, again, in prohibitive cost, I'm cool buying guys who may be flashes in the pan. Probably get Mooney for like a couple thirds right now. Take my thirds. Again, you can have them. Don't need them. I'd rather the points rather than the prospectus of a guy who I think maybe could score points one day, but probably will never. But again, I think Darnell Mooney has consistently been an underrated receiver in the NFL. He showed it early in his career in Chicago. The dude can separate. Dude can run routes. His hands, you know, haven't always been the most consistent thing in the world, but I think he's got the best quarterback he's played with to date. I think he's in an offense that fits his skill set most. And sure, he's going to have those games where he's not needed and he kind of disappears, but he's also going to have those games where he's just the consistent deep threat who burns coverage. And for the cost, I mean, so far this year, half PPR, he's wide receiver 14. Like, for a third round pick, I'll take that shot. Even if he settles down into, you know, high end wide receiver three range or low end wide receiver 2 in that 24 to 28 range, I'll take a third round pick for that all day.
I agree.
Dude's talented.
You can overpay for wide receivers that peak at wide receiver 24 in points per game, or you can pay way less than that for Darnell Mooney.
We love Darnell Mooney. But everybody, that has been another episode of the Dynasty Digest. Thank you all for tuning in. You can follow me on Twitter at Parry_FF. You can follow Tim on Twitter at Nubs with 2 N's and 2 B's. And you can find all things JWB at JWB_FF on Twitter as well. Make sure you guys check out the description down below where you can find links to our Discord, our Patreon, as well as our Clips channel. Make sure you guys sign up on Underdog Fantasy, where if you use code JWB at sign up, you can get a deposit match of up to $100. And as always, guys, we will see you in our next episode.